Welcome to Module 1. This module is separated into two parts, and this first learning objective will guide you through English as a global language. So how English came into existence and where we are with it now. We will look at English as a global context, and you will be able to evaluate the impact of English as a global language and how this is related to the TEFL industry today. The module will help you to identify, examine, and understand the relevant concepts and the history of key theoretical perspectives in TEFL methodology. So, the Anglophone world. What is the Anglophone world? This is something you will see quite a lot through the first part of this module. And this is just talking about English and an English-speaking person who would be an Anglophone. Lingua franca. So this is a common language, or perhaps a bridge language that students may have, or a link language. We can see it's quite synonymous, the different ideas that we can have for lingua franca. A lingua franca is used as a means of communication among speakers of other languages. So, what is a global language? So if we look at somebody quite prominent in the TEFL industry, named David Crystal, he has written quite a lot of books on English as a global language, and he quotes, "Language achieves a genuinely global status when it develops a special role that is recognised in every country." And this is his explanation of a global language. So let's try and relate that to English and TEFL a little bit. English is spoken globally, all around the world. In small corners in the world, you will find people speaking English. Think about tourism and reflect on tourism and how English is used. If you go to a hotel in Spain, in China, you may be welcomed by a receptionist who's speaking English to you. So this relates to what David Crystal said. A special role that is recognised in every country. Think about ELT. Can you remember ELT, the acronym we looked at in the introduction module? English language teaching. So if we think about English language teaching globally, people are learning English in every single corner of the world. And again, this relates to what David Crystal is saying, a special role that is recognised in every country. Let's look at business. Business around the world is often spoken in English. So perhaps as an English person going to Japan to meet Japanese clients, you'll be in a meeting and the common language will be English. In fact, later on in this module, you will see how big business English actually is. Many businesses only use English as one common language, even when their business is not located in the UK. Let's think about music. Let's think about the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, Adele. There is a huge music effect for English and its role as a global language. Every country you go to, you will hear music being played in English. So this is another reason why we have a special role that is recognised in every country. And one of the last factors to think about is literature. So let's think about Shakespeare, for example. Most people around the world know who he is. They've read some of the books or studied his literature at school. If we think about more modern day literature, we can think about Harry Potter and the huge influence that this has had globally. Pupils all around the world are reading Harry Potter in English as far away as Portugal and Brazil. Did you know? Let's have a look at some facts that really show and consolidate why English is such a global language. The world's most widely learned language is English. So remember that acronym ELT, English Language Teaching. English is spoken approximately by a quarter of the world's population. That's a huge number and shows us the power of English as a global language. Around 360 million people speak English as their first language. And as we go through this module, you will see the differences between people using English as a first language or perhaps a second language. Around 1 billion speak it as non-natives. English is spoken at a useful level by around 1.75 billion people. And at a useful level, what do we actually mean? This could mean communicating at work in English. It could be travelling and holidays, being able to order something in English in a restaurant or a cafe. Literature, as we said, has a huge influence on English becoming a global language, particularly William Shakespeare, a huge global influence throughout the world. English is also the leading language for scientific research around the world. So most publications, regardless of the country, will be published in English. And if, again, we go back to business, English is used predominantly in the areas of business, aviation. So let's think about aviation. Think about air traffic controllers. Think about airports in general. Even if the airport is in France, the signage will be in English. The people will be speaking in English. Air traffic controllers all around the world use English as their main language, their main point of communication. Similarly with technology. Technology has a huge influence with English. And if you look at the internet, for example, the predominant language is English. And as we mentioned before, music. The music industry has a huge global impact, and English or American music can be heard in every corner of the world. English has a huge impact globally, and countries may have English as their first language or a native language, or perhaps English that holds a legal status as the primary language or legal status as a secondary language. So let's look and focus on the countries where English is the official primary language. So, the UK, the USA, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. So this is the native language of all of these countries. Note there are differences. English is the dominant language, but perhaps some of the vocabulary used in Britain compared to America or Canada may be different. So always take note of the differences in words and phrases, and also the cultural differences in the choice of words may vary hugely between New Zealand and the USA, even though English is the common language. The primary language in countries and territories. So examples, the Republic of Ireland, Jamaica, Trinidad and Tobago, Guyana, the Bahamas, Belize, Grenada, Barbados, the United States Virgin Islands, the Channel Islands, Antigua and Barbuda, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, the Isle of Man, the Turks and Caicos Islands, St. Kitts and Nevis, the Cayman Islands, Gibraltar, Anguilla, and the Falkland Islands. If we now look at countries that have English as an official language, and these include Belize, Botswana, Cameroon, Eswatini, Fiji, Guyana, Ghana, India, Kenya, Kiribati, Lesotho, Liberia, Malta, Malaysia, Mauritius, Namibia, Nigeria, Pakistan, Palau, Papua New Guinea, the Philippines, Rwanda, St. Lucia, Samoa, the Seychelles, Sierra Leone, Singapore, the Solomon Islands, Sri Lanka, Sudan, South Africa, Tanzania, the Gambia, Zambia, and Zimbabwe. And this shows us globally, again, the presence that English has as a global language. We can see from these countries that have English as an official language that they are represented all over the world. So we're going to focus our attention a little bit on Katru. And Katru was an Indian linguist, and he came up with his idea about the concentric circles. And this may explain and help you understand English as a global language a little bit more. Katru was actually very, very famous, and he coined the term world English. So he developed the three circle model of world Englishes. So if we start with the inner circle, this was looking at traditional English speaking countries. So this would be the UK, for example. The outer circle are places where they speak official non-native varieties of English. And then the expanding circle, speakers in the expanding circle following the rules of the English language followed by the inner circle. So if we focus on this in more detail, the inner circle is going to be focusing on countries such as the UK, the USA, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. And these are countries where English is the primary language. And this is norm providing. So what does that mean? It means the norms of the English language were produced there. So the grammar, the structure, for example. And this is the model for English. The outer circle, so the second circle, is talking about English as a second language. And examples of this would be Singapore and Pakistan. And if we look at norm developing, it says the norms produced by the inner circle are further developed and reproduced in the outer circle. And this is when we may have examples of things like Spanglish, which perhaps is English with a mix of Spanish, or Hinglish, or even Singlish, a mix of languages together. And lastly, we have the expanding circle. And this recognises the importance of English, but in no official capacity. And we can include examples like China, Russia, and Brazil. So these countries are what we call norm dependent. They fully depend on the norms originally produced by the native speakers of that inner circle. And they don't reproduce any types of Englishes. One point to consider is the inner, outer, and expanding circles may change. The inner circle, not so much, but the outer circle and expanding circle, as time goes by, may change, and the influence of English may change. Let's focus on business English and look at how this has been such a determining factor in English becoming such a global language. English has a huge impact on business around the world, and actually many companies use an English-only policy. Why? This allows for simpler communication internationally. It also shows us the role of English as a global language when countries as far away as South Korea and Japan are using English as the main company language. So, why do companies often follow an English-only policy? One, easier communication. So perhaps if they're working with different people in different countries, they have one common language. Think about global business. Again, it makes it much easier. When there's one language, everyone can use that language to talk with each other. It creates a sense of unity to have one common language. Let's think about the ELT world of business. So let's go back to that acronym ELT, English Language Teaching. So as TEFL teachers or English language teachers, you may be asked to specialise in business teaching. You may have students who want to focus on accountancy vocabulary or marketing vocabulary, or want to be better at producing presentations in English. And this again shows us the huge dominance of English as a global language, because so many people require English classes specialised in niche business areas. Also, employability. For many people around the world, to have English on their CV means that they have better job prospects. They may have a higher remuneration because of their language abilities in English. And perhaps looking forward into the future, their job prospects are better because they speak English. And let's not forget international business travel. To be able to travel all around the world and speak and communicate, English is extremely useful. So, English-only policy, please. So let's have a look at some of the companies around the world that only use English, even though their headquarters and their main bases are not located in the UK. Sodexo, a French company. Siemens, Samsung, Nissan, Honda, and Renault. All of these companies have one thing in common. They have an English-only policy. So they've all adopted an English-only policy, making English the official language of their company. And they're scattered across the globe in different places, from France to Japan to Germany to China. As time goes by, possibly more companies will adopt and change to English only. Why? Let's think of an example. A Spanish colleague travels to Honda in Japan to meet Japanese colleagues, and they speak entirely in English because that's the common factor. It makes it much, much easier. So, English is an official language in companies around the world. Why do they do this? It is perhaps easier for a company to use a single language for communication and may increase efficiency when working with international partners. This makes international business and travel much easier when there's only one language to communicate in. It's highly likely that a Chinese businessman meeting a business partner in Spain will speak in English. The connection between English as a global language and GDP. So the connection suggests the power and influence is not just about the use of the language, but also the countries that use it. This in turn increases the economy and offers further job opportunities for people who can speak in English. Opportunities for jobs will increase, and of course there will be advantages for employees regarding salary implications. Let's have a look at regions and international bodies in which English is upheld as a recognised language. How many of these can you recognise? The WHO, UNESCO, UNICEF, NATO, the UN, the Olympic Committee, the World Bank. They all uphold English as a recognised language. Why? Very similar for the reason of businesses too. The ease of global communication. The message can be conveyed very clearly when there's one key language. And three, the global unity. The internet and English. So let's have a focus on the global influence of English on the internet. And think about how useful it is for learners who have instant access to information all in English. And this could be in films, in ebooks, in YouTube, music. A lot of these pages are targeted at learning English. Did you know that English is the most represented language used on the internet? It is around 25.5% of the main language used. Please bear in mind that this figure will change as time goes on. So, speaking English has many advantages in other countries around the world. It provides better opportunities in the workplace and provides ease of global travel. Social factors. Let's think back a bit to the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, Adele, and Elton John. What do they all have in common? Global popularity, global recognition, and this has helped to spread the English effect and help English become more of a dominant language. Again, referring back to literature, Shakespeare is renowned across the world for his works. This also has contributed to the global spread of English. This combined with the print of the Bible and that most scientific papers are published in English. If we come back to the ELT industry, so remember that acronym, English Language Teaching, we can see that many people around the world are currently studying English in some form. This could be at a private language school in the UK to increase fluency, at a college to pass an exam, abroad at a private language school for better employment opportunities, and perhaps at a university to increase overall opportunities. So let's think. Children may often start learning English before they start learning their own language. In many countries, children don't go to school till they're 6 or 7, but they start learning English in kindergarten or nursery or preschool when they're 3. Many young learners around the world follow the system of young learner exams. So they start doing exams in English at a very young age and low level and work their way through them. And this helps them to explicitly show their level of English. For some children, it's compulsory to learn English. It can be a sign of prestige and a way to improve overall future opportunities. Let's look at the importance of English in economic, social, and cultural terms. Let's pay our attention to the CEFR, the Common European Framework. Children learn English from a very young age and participate in young learner exams, then higher exams to perfect their English skills. As we've said, economically, English has an effect on GDP in a country. This can be seen as a powerful tool in some countries and give reason as to why English is such an influential factor. A higher remuneration package is generally available for people who speak English. Socially, there is so much. Let's think about a business meeting where many people gather together, one common language, they're using small talk in English. One language makes communication much simpler. So why is English a highly desirable language to learn? Better job opportunities? The possibility for global travel? Many tourists use English to communicate in many countries across the world. The language used on the internet most widely is English. There is a huge influence of English in media outlets, as we've looked at in music, television, and film. English is a business language, so can open many work opportunities and a higher salary with a good command of English. Let's pay our attention to the origins of English and how did it come about, specifically English as an Indo-European language. There are many branches and subgroups showing how English has evolved over time. Think of English as a family tree. Through history, there have been many influences that create new branches on this family tree. English has many branches. It's classed as a Germanic language with an Indo-European origin. Throughout the years, English has had so many influences, which have influenced the shape of English as we know it today. It started with Indo-European. It then has many branches which are related to different language groups. The influence of various language groups on English means we have inherited words and sounds and structures from Indo-European languages to Germanic languages and Romance languages. This tells us that English has borrowed massively to form English we know as modern English today. So where does English come from? It is from the Indo-European family following the Germanic branch. English is a Germanic language, but has borrowed massively from other languages, including Latin and Romance languages such as Greek and French. These borrowed words from other languages are known as loan words. History has played a massive role in shaping English as a global language. So let's go back in history a little bit more. The history of English as we know it today. English has many historical influences which have shaped the language we know today as modern English. We can trace it back to the 400s when Germanic tribes invaded. This left Germanic influences on the language. In 1066, the Normans invaded Britain and left a Latin Romance influence on the language. In the 1500s, the Industrial Revolution and the expansion of the British Empire helped shape the role of English as a global language. So let's think about English. It is an eclectic mix of words and languages borrowed from different languages due to the history. One, in the 400s, the Germanic tribes invaded, and this was the Anglo-Saxon or Old English, with a huge Germanic influence. Secondly, in 1066, the Normans invaded Britain, and this evolved to Middle English. And this was a combination of Old English plus Latin plus French influence. Thirdly, in the 1500s, there was the printing development and the Industrial Revolution, and also the expansion of the British Empire. And this became known as modern English. And this was when English really started setting itself on the global map. So we can see here there has been a huge Germanic influence, a Romance influence, and this has helped spread English. Let's consider some key points. The British Empire. So how did this help spread English as a global language? Invasions and war, and how military personnel, such as soldiers and sailors, helped spread English as a global language. Let's not forget the power behind the United States of America. There was a huge boom in the economy in America at the end of World War II, and this helped shape English as a global language. Because of trade to and from other countries, a single language was necessary. Other key areas which have contributed to the growth of English as a global language are scientific areas, economic factors, financial factors, and industrial factors like the rise of the Industrial Revolution. Let's look specifically at the Germanic roots. So languages evolve and change constantly. But did you know approximately 20% of English has Germanic roots in some way? So let's have a look at some examples. Think about this word, kindergarten. This actually is a German word. Kinder means children, and Garten means garden, or a garden for children. And we use the word kindergarten all the time in English. Let's have a look at some other words. Think about waltz. What does that mean to you? The dance, a Germanic root word. Stollen, a typical pudding ate at Christmas that has a Germanic influence. Bretzel, or pretzel, as we say it in English. Delicatessen is another example. Noodle and rucksack. So we can see how English has borrowed, or perhaps even stolen, words from other languages to shape English as we know it today. Let's look at Romance languages. So what do we mean by Romance languages? These are languages such as Latin, Spanish, French, and Greek. So English is not actually a Romance language because, as we've said, it's a Germanic language, but it has heavily borrowed or inherited over the years from Romance languages. So if we look at a percentage, around 29% of English words have some Latin form, specifically in key areas such as medicine and science. And as we know, most scientific research papers around the world are all written in English. So let's have a look at a Romance example. So let's look at the word postpartum. Post means after. Partum means bearing, birth, delivery. And this is a word that is integrated into the English language today, but actually has a Latin root. If we look a bit further at Romance languages and the influence on English, we can really see how these Latin roots are quite deep into English as we know it today. So let's have a look at the word villa. Definition, what is a villa? Well, in English, we could use it as villa, exactly the same, or perhaps a house. Lingua. So what does this mean, lingua? It actually means language. And how is it used in English? Language, linguistics. We can see how these words in English have derived from these Romance roots. Obscura. What does this mean? Well, actually, the definition of this word in Spanish and Italian is dark. Whereas perhaps in English, we would talk about obscure. Folium, a Latin word. Definition, leaf. Let's think about the word foliage that we use in English and take us back to the Latin root, folium. Populus, again the Latin word. It means people. So let's think about how this is used in English. And we can look at examples like populus or population. Densa, another Latin word. It means thick. How do we use it in English? So think about dense or density. And another example is umbra. What does that mean? Well, actually, it means shade. But think about how we've used this and changed it in English. If you think of umbrella, which is providing a shade, but comes from the word umbra, which is the Latin root. At the end of each module, there will be some key hashtag words and phrases. And these are key areas that we've looked at within the module. So let's have a look at some of the hashtag words from module one. Global language. So as we've said, English is a global language. And there are many reasons in history that have shaped English to becoming a global language. The Anglophone world. So English speaking people all around the world. International bodies using English. So let's consider UNESCO, UNICEF, all of these international bodies that use English as their common language. English and Germanic influences. So as we've said, English is a Germanic language, and therefore there are many Germanic influences within our vocabulary. English and Romance languages. So English is not a Romance language, but we have borrowed and inherited many words that have shaped English as we know it today. NATO, again, another example of an international body using English. Business English, so think about the importance of English and business. History and English, so the key factors that have shaped English and how it is today. And music and English. So let's reflect back on the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, and even Adele, and the effect that they have had on building English as a global language. Just for further consolidation, there are some recommended books that can help you consolidate and review what we've looked at in module one. So the first author to look at is David Crystal and his book, English as a Global Language. The second recommendation would be Dee Northrup, and this is How English Became the Global Language. So it's always recommended to do as much reading as possible around the topic, and this will help you in your understanding and the assessments overall. Have a look at the links below for further consolidation of the topic. The first one is the History of English. This consolidates the topic of English as a global language and provides further consolidation for you. And the second recommendation is a YouTube video that has funny short videos related to why English has become a global language.